birds living on the edge, and that's what the birds do, which are in the Sahel, over here. But I want to start with a German nobleman, Hans Freiherr von Berlepsch, because he was the inventor of the nest box, and many studies on climate change and the impact of climate change on birds would not have been possible without him. But there was a Dutchman, not a nobleman, just a simple teacher, an amateur, who saw his, as first in the world the possibility to study, to use nest boxes for bird studies. He made 100 nest boxes in 1909, really a long time ago, and after 2 years he had made 400 nest boxes, all in his former royal estate. And this work has been continued since then. And I show you another graph. Oh no, first. When he started his work, the great tit was the most common breeding bird in his nest boxes, and number two was the common redstart, more common than the blue tit. How much the world has changed without we knew. This shows you the population trend, the number of common redstart breeding in nest boxes over there in Holland. And you see that when he started, 30-35% of the nest boxes were occupied by common redstart. And in the mid-80s, it was 0.5%. And we, with all our short memory, are very happy the population is increasing. It's now 2-3 times more than in the mid-80s, indeed. But you see here, this is of course a very unique series of measurements. There are no other series which can look back so much. What is going on? Of course, the habitat changed locally in the forest. But the same trend I found in other series, and I found 30 long studies, long-term studies, which started somewhere here or over there. And they all show the same decline. So the question is, what is explaining this declining trend? There's a common factor. The common factor is 4,500 kilometers away in Africa. And I show you the same graph, and I add as blue bars, the variation in rainfall in the Sahel in the wintering area. And what you see is that the population went down very fast here in the dry 1940. The population was able to increase in the period when the Sahel was very wet with a rainfall of 20-30% above the long-term average, then went down very much and now a very small increase. Also for more recent years, not shown here. And the photograph shows you their habitats, scattered acacia trees south of the Sahara. And you see the conclusion, there's a low decline every year when it is very dry in Sahel, a high mortality over there, and a small increase after a wet year, not sufficient to compensate all these losses. And from that we conclude that the habitat is changing as hell. That is a long-term impact, explaining the population real decline and declining. And at the same time, there's a short-term impact. Every year when it's very dry, there's a high mortality over there. But of course, rain can also be a long-term impact. If the real climate is changing, it will have a long-term impact on the number of birds which can survive over there. And what I show you now for the redstart is also true for other birds, for the tree pipit, for the wryneck, for the white throat, for the woodchuck fry, the turtle dove, and for the bonelli warbler. All species which have in common that they winter, and they are declining, and that they winter just south of the Sahara. It's also true for the species over here. Species of which from southern Europe, of which we do not know the trend, whether they are increased or not. We know how many birds more or less are breeding now in Europe. We know for the species, at least for the species which I showed you red arrow, how much they have declined. The population was 3, 5, 6 times larger in the past. And if you add all these losses, we arrive at a loss of 1,000,000,000 of birds, which have been lost from the long distance migrants. And the big question is why, how can we explain this huge decline? We can say, well, of course the Sahel is an ecological disaster area. And you can say, well, desertification going on. But if you read scientific papers, you can see there were a lot of papers about desertification up till about 1990. But then after the recovery of the rainfall, there are no papers anymore. Because now you have a desertification in reverse. So it was just a long, many years of low rainfall when it seems to be a desertification going on. So that's not really an explanation. Is it then deforestation? You see, I put a question mark. Of course, 100 million people have to collect every day again wood for cooking. But what you see here, this lady is collecting dead wood, just found on the ground. And what you see, the local people just knew their knife to cut branches. They harvest wood. They normally don't cut trees themselves, not the local people. I do not want to deny the problem. Within some years, half the population is living in cities in Western Africa. And these people prefer not wood, they prefer charcoal. And for making charcoal, you don't need small branches, you need real wood. So that's one of the reasons why, indeed, trees are cut now, more and more. But the point I want to make is we have a decline of 80-90% of the woodland birds breeding in Europe and wintering over there. While the decline of the woody cover is much less. You can see just by comparing the high resolution satellite images of Google Earth, for instance, comparing that to aerial photographs being made in the 50s and the 60s, and you see some changes, but actually not such a huge decline of the woody cover. And more global studies being done in the last 20 years show you that, in fact, the Sahel is more green than it was 20 years ago. Also an increase of the woody cover. Again, how to explain the huge decline of these birds bound to trees? Fortunately, BirdLife International has given us the opportunity to study it. And for that, we did very simple, old-fashioned field work. Walking there, counting birds, counting trees. And we did so from in Mauritania, 100 millimeter of rain, yes, here, up to Guinea-Bissau, we have more than 2,000 millimeter of rain. Also here, and next week I will continue working here again, and also in Burkina Faso, because we have not enough data. I said old-fashioned fieldwork, but in fact, our shoecase is full with electronic equipment. It's the real changes. So if I mean, arrive next week, I hope to walk here, and with my field computer, walk with my own, in my own image, and know exactly which tree I have to count, because I can see it while I'm walking. And of course, we measure the trees with laser beams, etc. In the Southern Sahara, you walk in the sand dunes, and then you see in these acacia trees, I hope to see the same species, Acacia tilis, next week here, this week here in Israel. But here there are some birds in it, that's for sure. And if you go a little bit to the south, then you have more acacia trees in the valleys between the dunes. And this is real rich in birds, especially Palearctic birds from the north. And then, if you go a little bit to the south, only 50 kilometers, you have 300 millimeter of rain, and then you see a part of the 1,000,000 goats and geese, which are grazing there in the short rainy season, eating grass. The rest of the year they eat from the shrubs and the trees. And then another 50 kilometer further south, you are in the area where it was in the past a woody savanna, and it's now by the farmers being converted into this landscape. They have croplands here, but they have removed all trees except one, the white acacia. Fortunately, that's a tree which is very attractive for for our bus pieces. And if you go south, you see the landscape change while you're driving by car. So from the desert up till this landscape, with kapok trees and palm trees and rain-fed rice field, is only 300-400 kilometers. And this zone, our birds have to find their place. Altogether, we know now the bird density for the number of birds per square meter canopy for 189 woody species. We did that in many trees, and we counted all per tree species, and per tree we noted the birds being present. And we know for that in baobab trees we have never seen a palaeolithic bird. Our birds are extremely selective in that choice of the tree. Oh, I see. That's different than at home. In any case, what I want to, using all these data, we can calculate that in the Western Sahel, 300 million migrants bound to trees are found. So if you extrapolate it for the total Sahel, you arrive at about 1 billion birds. And we know that we have never seen a palaeolithic bird in 105 of these woody species. Some rare species, but also in some very common tree species, we have never seen a bird. Most important result, 81% of all our birds are present in only 9 tree species, mainly acacias. So the question was, can we explain the decline of the migrants? Yes, I can. We can replace it by another question. Can the decline of the migrants be explained by the decline of the preferred tree species? And it will take another half an hour to explain, but the answer is yes, we can. We know now what's going on. So we are happy with that. I want to continue. We see now that the many birds bound to trees are declining, not only Sahel, but also further south. And the same is true for birds which are found in the open savanna, not bound to trees like the white stork. In open savanna, nearly 70% of the bird species are declining. And from the European species found in bound to wetlands in Africa, also more than half is declining. So the conclusion is, we lost in the Sahel, in the woody savanna, in the open savanna, in the wetlands, in total 12 to 50% of the total European bird population the last 40 years. So a real huge impact. Now I want to start speculating about the future. And what is the driving force of all these changes to increase the human population? The human population is increasing 3% per year and will increase also for 3% per year in the next 20, 30 years. And the grazing pressure by the goat, the sheep, the cattle increase even faster. As you see here, you see the dots here, sorry, the dips here, and there are dry years where many animals died. But you see since here, a fast increase. And this has, of course, an impact. There's much to say about that, but in any case, there are more people, also more birds are killed for food. And especially fishermen are very clever bird catchers. They know how to catch them with snares and things like that. And the problem is, if you walk just here, you see that they prefer to catch red list rare species, endangered species. And you can find here the remnants along the waterline. People, the problem in the Sahel is very dry, but there are some very large wetlands. And these wetlands are fed by rivers here from the south. And because this raining season is very short, only some months, in a short time, large areas are flooded, and after half a year, it is all dry again. And so you know all Lake Chad, but in the Niger Delta, it's very rich in birds. And see, people are concentrated there, but also birds. They are the real hot spots in the Sahel. But people, just to raise the production, agricultural production, have made dams for irrigation, but also for electricity, and This has a negative impact on this floodplain downstream, especially here for the Senegal Delta, which is more or less lost fully. And that will continue in the future. There will be more dams to feed all these people, as it has a huge impact on these remaining floodplains. And this shows you how an area like the Inner Niger looks like at high water. It looks like a meadow, and it is a meadow, but there's 5 meters of water. During rising water, the grasses are growing and growing with the rising water, 5-6 centimeters a day. So they have stems of 5-6 meters, 7 meters. And then when the water goes down again, all these stems are floating and many, many birds, millions and millions, are just feeding there. And one of them is the black-crowned night heron. And just when you're counting in some sites, the birds passing you in the late evening, and you count then 14,000-15,000 birds, you realize I've counted now more than all birds being present in Europe. I must have counted already a part of the Asian population. So it shows you how important these floodplains are in Western Africa. And the birds are vulnerable. This shows you for the night heron, in the red line here, the fluctuation of the population in southern France and the Camargue. Fluctuated between 900 in the 60s and less than 300 in the 80s. But the blue area here shows you the surface area from the floodplains in Africa. From the Inner Niger Delta, light blue, varying between 7,000 and 23,000. And that's information you can just extract from satellite images combined with the water level being measured every day. And in dark blue, the Senegal Delta, with a quarter of the dams, and hardly anything is left. And what you see, they're singly. So the conclusion is clear. The population size of the night heron in Europe is determined in Africa. It's the size of the feeding area, the flood extent. I could go on and want to speculate about the impact of climate change. Well, we've seen already today the what's indicated here is red, the long-term change in the climate, in the temperature worldwide. The temperature goes up faster in Western Africa, as you see, just a blue line. And the climate models predict that the temperature in the Sahel will go up by 2 to 7 degrees Celsius in a world which is already so hot. What will be the impact on the birds? What I know in any case from other studies is that if the temperature goes up 2 degrees, the evaporation will go up. But by consequence, the discharge of the river will go down. And the calculations are that there will be a decline of 10%. But I have calculated myself the correlation, the relation between the discharge and the size of the floodplain is very narrow. So we know that a reduction of this discharge, 10%, will cause a decline of the floodplains of more than 20%. So this will have surely an impact on the wetlands birds like this night heron. Temperature, but it's more, what about rainfall? Well, there are many rainfall stations since about 100 years, but there are some which start much earlier, like in Saint-Louis in Senegal. And what you see here is that for the last years, the overall trend is downwards. And Nicholson has done some reconstruction of the climate in the Sahel. And what you see, over the long term, for the last 500 years, the trend is downwards. But you see also, and it's important to note, large variation. There are long periods which very dry and long periods when the rain was large. And now we are somewhere here. And of course, when you see, as an ornithologist, a graph like this, then you start to think about if this decline has such an impact on the red start, what would be having a contribution of the European avifauna in this time here? Now about 25% of all birds, and also of the total 8 billion birds in Europe, winter south of the Sahara. Has that been 20, 30, has that been more, 30, 40%? Nobody knows. But you realize that this must have an impact of the contribution of all these birds. not wish for long distance migrants. Well, I hope to be, this is a sad story altogether. I want to try to be, to end a bit optimistic. But I'm afraid that after what we learned this morning, that with a dry Israel and a dry Mediterranean, I'm afraid again, I will not end optimistic. What I want to say is that in fact, birds will lose, that's for certain, a lot southern of the Sahara. So the long distance migrants will in the future real lost ground. And the question is, will all birds decline? Well, birds do surprise us more than once. And we know already that birds were able the last 20, 30 years, also long distance migrants, to shift their wintering area. We know, for instance, for the white stork, that more and more white storks are wintering north of the Sahara, in northern Africa. I understood also in Israel are more wintering white storks. We know a lot, large numbers are now wintering in Spain and in France. The same is true for the marsh area. The godswits more and more are wintering now in the rice fields in Spain and in Portugal. The little egrets, a species which is increasing, but has learned to spend the winter along the Atlantic coast and also in the Mediterranean. And of course, because the winters are already milder, more mild than they were in the past, they can do. The spoonbill, another species which is increasing in Western Europe, booming really. But all these numbers now more and more are wintering already in Southwest Europe. And of course, the black cap, which the German black caps were flying to the south, and more birds are flying to Britain. So birds can surprise us. Let's hope that they, more and more birds are able indeed to find a site, wintering site, north of the Sahara. And at the moment, Israel and the surrounding countries is tremendously important as a stopover site. And so let's hope in the future that more birds will be able to winter here. And if we all help them to find a good site here, that will be possible. But it also depends on the climate change here. Thank you. Oh, yeah.
Thanks, Dr. Swart, for an amazing lecture.